through the carbonate, that's how I got free. Jabba back off because there's no stopping me. Postmodern player, sample-tastic, flows ekphrastic, I get drastic. Hey, watch the plastic, yo, I name check and leave you drastic.
Welcome to the MacGuffin, episode 220. Woo-hoo. I'm Spencer.
I'm Greg.
Today, in honor of the release of Gangster Squad, we're going to be talking Josh Brolin, a fixture in Hollywood for the last, I don't know, 30 years or so. But really, he only has exploded into popularity, I would say, in the last
five years.
Or at least critical acclaim and whatnot.
Definitely.
I mean, Goonies notwithstanding.
Yeah,
I always love him for that. But I'm probably in the small minority
who really love him in Goonies.
I don't think he's top line Goonies material. That's all I'm saying. I love everyone, but he's like sixth or seventh on the depth chart.
Well, fair enough.
That being said, why don't we start by talking about the Goonies?
Yes. Big film debut.
Yes, and this is obviously, you know, the Spielberg produced. I think he also wrote the story. Spielberg wrote the story and produced it.
I think he made it directed like one segment, like one scene or something.
Chris Columbus wrote the screenplay. Yes. Richard Donner directed, produced it. So
The Don,
yeah. Lethal Weapon, whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
This is the story of, you know, a group of kids who find a treasure map and follow it, essentially, to save their families.
Follow it to
homes.
Treasure.
Yeah, I mean, their families are essentially, I don't know what you want to call them, destitute.
Yeah, I think it's like the area's getting, like, repossessed, or like they're building new housing.
They're going to bulldoze their house. I think they're building a golf course.
Yeah, something like, yeah.
But
they're the goon squad from, that's what they call themselves.
Yeah, the Goonies.
Yeah.
You know, I saw this when I was a kid. I don't know about you.
Definitely.
Obviously, I've heard from people who did not see it as a kid that they're not nearly as engaged by it.
Yeah, I've heard that. I think the nostalgia aspect of it maybe endears people a little bit more to it, but I still think it's a great film, so it's hard for me when I'm watching it to not be overcome with how endearing it is.
Even ignoring that sort of weird ignorance, if you ask me. The thing that stands out the most to me is, like, this is up there with Home Alone and sort of like the dream scenario for a kid.
Oh, totally.
Like, this is like the kind of shit I would imagine when I was a kid. I was like, ooh, that rock must be treasure. This is something exciting.
After this movie, I think me and my brother both became miniature Datas and had little tool belts full of things and all sorts of
chattery teeth all of a sudden became useful. That's a whole other thing. Like, I didn't even think about, like, the data aspect. Yeah. Like, just looking, going on adventures is cool, but then coming up with cool contraptions and shit, like...
Yeah, between that and, like, riding around on bikes and, like, looking for lost treasure. How cool is that in Astoria?
Yeah, Astoria, where it was filmed, which I've actually bounced around and trying to, like, find locations. I mean, some of it's down in, like, Cannon Beach.
Yeah.
Some of the locations don't even exist anymore.
Correct.
That they built for the film.
Like the ship, the pirate ship, which, like, unfortunately was entirely real. Well, fortunately was entirely real.
Or the restaurant, too.
And they didn't show any of the kids the ship until they...
Yeah, they slid down the tubes, and when they came out, the reactions to the ship in the movie are their actual reactions.
With the exception of Data's, because he said, holy shit, and he wasn't supposed to say it, they re-shot it.
Not gonna bump it up from whatever.
But after the film, it was offered if anyone wanted to take the ship, and no one said they did, so the ship was scrapped.
It's hard to imagine that they'd make a theme park or something.
Seriously.
It seems like just...
Next time you're going to destroy an awesome ship, call the MacGuffin, and we will find somewhere to put it. I will move out of my apartment and
into
that ship.
It, yeah.
Well, the whole MacGuffin cast will just move into the ship.
That'd be awesome.
That would be sweet.
Yeah. I don't know if it's seaworthy, though.
Despite what the movie tells you. Definitely not anymore.
Well, it's probably on boards. They probably float still. Like, I don't know.
Fair enough.
But it's a great film. One other thing I want to mention, though, is not necessarily an award-winning film.
Yes.
But it got nominated for a bunch of youth awards, which I thought was pretty cool. I mean, granted, it didn't... Sean Astin won for Best Performance by a Young Actor, but there's a lot of nominations for Exceptional Young Actors and Actresses Award and stuff like that. The thing that sort of infuriated me, to say the least, was that Jeff Cohen, a.k.a. Chunk, was nominated. Corey Feldman, a.k.a. Mouth, was nominated. Do you know which child was not nominated?
Data.
Yep.
Come on, man.
Sons of bitches. Like, I'm not going to say it's racist,
but it was
kind of racist.
It's pretty racist.
Yeah, so, because, like, who did, like, I mean, they're all great, but, like, Data...
Like, awesome. I think I remembered, I think people, it probably goes in order of kids. If they don't remember Sean Austin right away, it's Chunk Data. Like, I think Chunk Data, everybody else.
Yeah, I think, like, I mean, Corey Feldman, like, that's what I'm saying.
I forget,
like,
he's in it.
Well, I mean, like, I mean, we haven't even talked about Brolin, who plays Sean Astin's older brother, yes. And who's sort of like yanked into the adventure because he's chasing after the kids initially, and then he sort of gets caught up in the adventure.
Young adults that he's hanging with.
And so, I mean, you know, I would say the four young kids are like the top liners. Yeah. Then you have the Fratellis with Robert Davi, Joe Pantoliano, and Ann Ramsey.
Joey Pants.
All
man.
Great. And then I would say Brolin checks in. And he's good in the movie. He's very good.
He's a great older brother. He's very convincing.
His role, it's kind of almost like mostly the straight role in the movie. Yeah, everyone else is crazy around him.
He's basically there to provide the element that these are not kids are not completely running amok. Is that he's the responsibility that's chasing after them, essentially, through the film. Trying to catch up and get them back home
and
to where they can
keep
be safe
them alive
and parental.
During the crazy stuff. Yeah. And, so.
Another sad thing about this movie, according to Sean Austin, or Astin, he got to keep the map.
Mm,
but
nice.
Years later, his mom thought it was a crinkled piece of paper and threw it away.
That is the downright tragedy.
Mrs. Assistin.
Yeah.
Damn you!
You're dead to us.
McGuffin dead says, you are dead to us. Yeah. I hope you're not actually dead, because that would be really sad.
We'll pour one out for you either way. jumping forward, I mean, he did lots of TV shows.
Yeah.
I believe he was in, like, 21 Jump Street in an episode and stuff like that. But, like, in the 90s, he sort of filled in smaller sort of roles. I mean, he was a villain in the Mod Squad movie.
A lot of small roles that kind of slid under the radar.
Well, one of sort of the interesting projects that he was in that really, I mean, has become more interesting as time has gone on was Mimic.
Yes.
The Guillermo del Toro film, which is his American debut.
Yes.
I mean, this is, if you're thinking Guillermo del Toro chronology, this is between Kronos and The Devil's Backbone.
Mm-hmm.
So this is, I mean, I think there's like 4 years between them. Starring Mira Sorvino and Peter Northam, I believe it was.
Jeremy Northam.
Sorry. As Peter.
I see what you got.
It's like some dyslexia or something there. Anyway. Yeah. Anyway, they play scientists who are tasked with combating a insect virus that has become prevalent in, I believe it's New York.
Yeah, it starts off with like a cockroach infestation that's targeting and making kids sick.
And so they create some bugs that are essentially supposed to kill these cockroaches and die off.
They genetically engineer like a new bug that has an enzyme that will kill cockroaches, but only that are all sterile and they have like a 6 month lifespan. Yeah. So then the film jumps like 3 years forward, and obviously something has gone amiss with said insects.
And said insects have become the size of humans and even look like humans and starting to
full-on mimics, because they're, as the movie tagline like one sentence description of the movie is like, they have to go after their only predator they have, man.
And I mean, you know, it's I mean, I love Mira Sorvino, and I mean, I'm a big fan of Charles Dutton. But it's like, I honestly could barely even remember Josh Brolin in this film.
Yeah,
like,
he's a police officer that is kind of friends with Jeremy Northam's character, and like helps, basically like calls in Jeremy Northam and Mira Sorvino to investigate stuff.
Which I think, I mean, really speaks to his place in Hollywood at that time, in the sense that like he could get stuff, but he really wasn't getting any meaty work.
Yeah.
Like, it was just sort of like,
spoiler alert, he doesn't last that long.
I don't think anyone's surprised by that revelation when I say he gets, like, nothing meaty.
Yeah.
Except, I guess, technically, he is meat in this scenario.
It's true, yeah.
If you really want to think about it.
He almost gets away, and then he gets eaten.
That's how horror films usually go, though.
It's true.
I mean, I think I saw this in the theater, as I recall, and, you know, it gets a lot of shit. And, I mean, in fact, even as we talked about before, you filmed, Guillermo del Toro has essentially detached himself from the movie
because he got
so screwed over by it. But I still like it. And, you know, they've done a director's cut since then, which excised a lot of the second unit directing that was done, including stuff by Robert Rodriguez, believe it or not.
Interesting. I don't think that's the one I saw. I'm pretty sure Netflix probably had the...
But fundamentally, to me, I like the idea behind the movie. And that's the thing that stands out to me. Like, this is the same sort of thing as, you know, like... things like Mothman prophecies, where it's like that sort of unsolved mystery shit, like, you know, like
could be there, true, yeah, Art, like, Bell stuff, which we all know you're a huge fan.
Yeah.
like right on the edge, like Chupacabra, Loch Ness style.
Could there be some sort of like insect creature living in the tunnels under New York City that was like looks like a person and is like, could this shit happen? Of course, I think
they have that
could.
great moment in the film where they're like, oh, like how have people not noticed this? And then they're like, maybe we have. And
yeah, just, how would you like, know if they look like that? Yeah, if you just like, thought they were like people
and
like, in like...
people randomly disappearing with someone that looks like they're in a dark coat. I mean, that doesn't... In New York,
that wouldn't set off any alarm.
None at all.
I mean,
people
like,
walk over dead people in
think
New
about,
York.
Like, so. Yeah, think about it this way. I mean, in a city with that many people, how many people do you like intently look at
or get close to? And how many people have to be go missing a day before you actually start looking into it?
Or think about now. Like, if it occurred now.
Oh, Lord.
How many people have, like, iPods and stuff in? Nobody pays attention to their surroundings. Mm-hmm. Like, nobody. Like, and so...
It's funny. Like, I want to watch the director's cut of this movie now because watching it kind of feels like a TV edit of something Guillermo del Toro would do. You can tell, like, the beginning intro and the feel of the film. You can totally tell it's Guillermo del Toro, but then it gets this kind of saccharine, watered-down third act.
I mean, you gotta consider, I mean, at his place. Like, I, as much as I love Kronos and then this and then The Devil's Backbone after it, like... It's not like not everyone's gonna be J.J. Abrams and get like a $75 million film out the gate, like with Tom Cruise backing you. Like, so to get this opportunity, I mean, Mira Sorvino at this point was sort of, I believe this was post Mighty Aphrodite, so she had won an Academy Award.
And I don't
at this
remember
point.
It. Yeah, this would have to be around the same time Replacement Killers, maybe before.
Yeah, so I mean, she was definitely in the sort of popping category, but she's not like, you know, I don't know, Julia Roberts or something at that time. Like,
this
so,
was in that her 90s hump that went up and then quickly down.
So, I mean, I think it was a nice opportunity. I think it was a cool idea. But, sadly, circumstances kind of limited it versus what his original vision was.
Yeah.
I still think it's fun, but I wish he could have done what he wanted.
Yeah, he disowned it after he clashed a lot with Bob Weinstein, who would frequently visit the set to make unreasonable demands about what should be shot, deviating away from the script. So it's not just that he's saying that they should shoot other stuff, he's saying he should shoot stuff that's not even the script. And since then, Del Toro has never again worked with Weinsteins. Not like it friggin' matters, because he makes amazing movies and a lot of money now, so he doesn't need them.
I think he'll be fine. Pacific Rim looks pretty awesome.
Yeah,
that's all I got to say about that.
Yeah.
Moving forward, though, a lot of the stuff we're going to skip over just because we want to talk about mostly the last half decade, because he has been prolific, and that really vaulted him to attention with No Country for Old Men. Mm-hmm. This is obviously the Coen Brothers film about a man who finds a whole bunch of, I believe it's drug money.
Yeah, he finds like a bunch of dead drug dealers and their cash
and
in the
decides,
middle of nowhere.
You know, keep it.
Look it.
That, what could go wrong?
what could go wrong?
Javier Bardem is what could go wrong. Who is quite possibly one of the most terrifying, real life-esque type characters. Like, he's not a Jason, he's not a Freddy, he's not indestructible, he's not from a demon from hell or something like that. He's just a dude who is scary as fuck.
Mm-hmm.
Like, when
he's like Dahmer in the sense where this thing that's scary about him is that he is a normal person who's just really thought out what he wants to do and just does it, sticks to that.
I mean, Dahmer's a good comparison, but I would even say maybe Ted Bundy.
Yeah.
Like somebody who's
definitely,
like actually like Dahmer, I feel like was a little bit in, you know, the shadows.
It's
like
true.
He didn't want to be exposed.
I'm more mad about the craziness and the scariness once you were in that web.
Ted Bundy had like a charismatic sort of way about him that he would manipulate.
Javier Bardem's not that charismatic in this film.
I think he is. Like there's that scene with the clerk in the store where he has him flip the coin about whether he's going to live or die.
I think that's more scary than charismatic, though. Intimidating.
But I mean, I think he has that sort of presence of, like,
intimidation,
you know,
is one side of charisma.
Exactly. And I think just, like, even more than when he's actually fucking killing people, like, I found that moment to be scary because it's just sort of, like, he...
That crazy pneumatic piston...
Yeah, was it the cow?
Yeah, I forget what it's called, staple gun or something.
Yeah, I think it kills.
Yeah, it's meant to kill cows in the slaughterhouse so that there won't be stray bullets.
But, like, it's so
much of leaving life and death to the simple flip of a coin, as opposed to, like, you know, I want to kill you, I'm coming after you, something like that.
And it said it so early in the film, they definitely set a dangerous precedence for his character that makes him intimidating. Poor Josh Brolin, though, he basically spends this whole movie running.
Which is interesting because, I mean, we were talking before it started that I was comparing this to The Village in the sense that, it was, I think that was a little bit before this.
Yeah.
But in the sense that the main character for the first half of the movie suddenly is out of the movie in this movie. I mean, Josh Brolin's time in the movie, I mean, I'm gonna say spoilers, I guess, but it's not really spoilers since this film has been Academy nominated. Yes. Most everyone knows it. It's only halfway through the movie too that he dies.
Mm-hmm.
Like Javier Bardem catches up with him and kills him. Like, so, you know.
But you know, even though he dies, I find it interesting the following fact. I don't know how you say it. It's just first name, but Moss, Josh Brolin's character,
Llewellyn.
There we go. Yeah. When Llewellyn Moss crosses the border into Mexico in the film, he becomes the first character in a Coen Brothers movie to set foot outside the United States.
That's interesting.
Except for their contribution to the anthology film Paris, Je T'aime.
Oh, yeah.
No other film written or directed by the Coens takes place in a foreign country.
Very interesting.
You ever wanted to think about how solid they are as American filmmakers? There you go.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting. And I think the thing that makes us better than The Village in my estimation is
everything.
Javier Bardem. Like, at the end of the day,
it's not M. Night Shyamalan, and it is the Coen brothers. Yeah. There's two pretty strong
points. Josh Brolin is great. Tommy Lee Jones is very good.
Oh, yeah.
But this is really Javier Bardem's film to star. And that's, I mean, that's no surprise that he won Best Supporting Actor. Mm-hmm. For it, because he's so captivating. I mean, and he's just, again, much like Josh Brolin, he's skyrocketed ever since then, you know, with, was it Skyfall and whatnot?
Yes,
ever
yes. Since then. So. First Spanish actor to win a Best Supporting Actor Oscar.
Obviously won Best Picture, Best Directors, Best Writing.
Yeah, interestingly enough, Best Directors, because it's the second film in history to have Best Director, to win Best Director, between and have that shared between two directors, the other one being West Side Story.
Well, I mean,
Jerome Robbins and Robert Wise.
I think mostly, I forget if it's the Directors Guild or whatever that really is not big on sharing credits. So.
Yeah, and that's actually why they have like a pseudonym for the person that's edited the film that has edited, and same with, I think, produced. They use pseudonyms for both of them, and they've used that same pseudonym for like every film since Blood Simple, because that same thing, like Directors Guild,
I mean,
Screen Guild, are like, you can't.
Same thing happened with Sin City. I believe Robert Rodriguez left the Directors Guild because they wouldn't credit Frank Miller for being a director on it. So, you know, great film, though. Obviously, everyone who was involved with it blew up, including Josh Brolin, and that
pretty close to the book from what I hear, too. Interestingly enough, it's a Coen Brothers film that cut down on dialogue from the original script because the book was... But everything up to the, even like the last speech happening with Tommy Lee Jones, like... Pretty close to the book, from what I've heard.
I believe it, and we'll get to my reason why shortly. But, you know, the same year, he also had, this is sort of an interesting string of films based on real people that he's been involved with. He was involved in American Gangster, the Ridley Scott-directed film starring Russell Crowe and Denzel Washington.
The much head-scratched and maligned MacGuffin film.
Well, I've
I only say that because between the two of us, I think in the last 6 months, we've probably talked about this film at least two times, not counting today.
Yeah, I mean, probably Russell Crowe and probably Ridley Scott. I don't know.
Maybe. Denzel, maybe?
Have we done Denzel?
I think it was Denzel.
We very well maybe in three then.
Yeah.
I think we skipped it for one of them. But my point with talking about it this time, I mean, we've talked about my confusion over how they could try and make Denzel Washington characters likable. The thing that I find interesting is Josh Brolin's character played Detective Truppo, who's a corrupt cop, fundamentally, and he's trying to put the squeeze, trying to use the lingo, on Frank Lucas, Denzel Washington character.
Yes.
And ultimately, the film pivots on Denzel Washington character essentially ratting out all these dirty cops. And suddenly, who goes from like this sort of side character who's kind of like obnoxious to being the main villain. And it's sort of like, wait a minute. I mean, I'm not in favor of corrupt cops.
Yes.
But it feels weird that we're trying to make him suddenly this worst figure in this sort of scenario.
Yes. While I can understand in the long run, especially because it's based on reality, why Richie Roberts would want to side with Frank Lucas instead of, what was the cop's name? That Josh Brolin played?
Detective Truppo.
Yeah, then Detective Truppo, because it's like, you know, what's worse, a criminal that's turned into a good guy or a good guy that's turned into a criminal? And I think most people probably think the latter is worse.
I think it's even more minutiae than that, though, because, I mean...
I would agree. It's how they handled it. Well, it makes it seem much more flippant.
As far
than
as,
that.
Like, it is, like, you know, Denzel Washington's character is, like, the drug kingpin. Like, mm-hmm. you talk about, like, ratting out people upwards. Like, yeah. he is
yeah,
upwards.
That's true.
Plus, he's, like... We've seen him murder people, so mm-hmm. there's no question whether he like, in terms of Josh Brolin's character, like, he's done some shady stuff.
Oh, yeah.
But as far as we know, he's not a drug kingpin, and he's not, like, a excessive murderer. Like,
that's true.
So, like, you know, is it better that he's trying to change his life, even though he's done all this horrific stuff, or he's sort of bad, and then we're trying to clean it up?
I don't know. I would say, if 100% of non-corrupt cops that you talk to hate corrupt cops more than most things.
I know, we're talking criminals, though, too. So it's sort of like criminals and corrupt cops are probably one, like, two of the same shades.
Well, what's
or whatever,
so weird, too, is just like, you know, because it's based on true story, and Richie Roberts went on to become Frank Lucas's lawyer after he left the police force, or I don't know if he left or if he got kicked out. But
I think he was studying during the movie.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, and he becomes Frank Lucas's lawyer, but to add an extra layer of weirdness to that, it's not just like, they were lawyers maybe once, and they kind of got along. But after that, Rich Roberts is a godfather to Lucas's son. Like, that's how ingrained he is into that family. So clearly, Spencer, no matter what he did before, he is sucking his metaphorical cock. Because he really loves that guy now, I guess.
I would love for people to write in and tell us who's worse, Josh Brolin's character or Denzel Washington's character. I'm probably in the minority who votes Denzel Washington, but, you know, I'd love to hear people's rationale on
I like to argue for devil's advocate, but I really also agree with you that it's pretty strange.
I'm
mostly
curious.
Because the whole movie is set up about how Denzel Washington is the rise to the ultimate badass, and Russell Crowe is fighting him.
And
then the end is that they both kind of give up on what they're doing and turn against the people trying to get them.
I think the message of the movie is give up.
Oh, like, okay.
Give up and roll over.
It's basically give up with the movie and turn it off before it ends.
Nice.
Agreed.
I can embrace that. I can embrace that. Moving right along, though. Mm-hmm. Again, another true to life story.
Yes.
He took on George W. Bush in the movie
W.
This is the Oliver Stone directed story that tackles the life of George W. Mm-hmm. Bush over the course, I think it's of four decades. I think it starts in the 60s,
and
skips to the 70s, and then goes...
Yeah,
like,
and they filmed it chronologically, and Josh Brolin like lost a bunch of weight to play young him, mm-hmm. and then gained weight, you know, classic character actors.
But he was even, like, I believe, the third choice.
Christian Bale was initially cast as Bush and underwent weeks of prosthetics tests before filming
which
again.
Which you know he would do. Yeah.
However, he withdrew from the production at last moment, prompting Oliver Stone to immediately look for a replacement, and Josh Brolin was given the role based on his performances in No Country and American Gangster.
And he spent, I mean, it's not to say that Christian Bale did any more or less than Josh Brolin. Mm-hmm. Josh Brolin spent a lot of time watching him, mimicking.
Yeah.
Like,
he called hotels and would just, like, talk to people in the accent.
Well, and I think he, like, even got to the point where he, like, different time periods, he changed his walk.
Interesting.
Because he noticed George W. Bush walking different and
stuff.
It's
interesting that this is the only movie about a U.S. president to happen while that president was still president. Like,
that is interesting.
I forget that primary colors happened afterwards, Clinton was out. Because it seemed to me like it was so close.
Yeah, it did.
Like, probably started production while he was still president and then ended. But the only one about a president to be.
Yeah, this is pretty close, too, though. I mean, this is, what, 2008? So, like,
it's true.
He was probably.
But, I mean, even then, that means you're starting a film in this president's second term. I mean, he's been around a while.
I think the thing that's most surprising to me, though, is how, like, fair, I guess. I don't know what you would call it. How generous it is.
Level-handed?
Yeah,
like
towards it is.
Even-handed, I guess?
Towards it is towards George W. Bush.
Yeah.
Because when I heard Oliver Stone... Yeah, sympathetic. That's a great term. When Oliver Stone was directing...
Oh, I know.
George, I was like, he's going to fucking skewer the shit out of him.
Oh, yeah, he's
going to
bend him over
like,
the...
It's going to be like Fahrenheit 9/11, the George W. Bush version, dramatic version.
But it was exactly the opposite.
No, I mean...
Saccharine.
He shows a very different side of him. You know, he shows the fucked up young George W. Bush, the one who has aspirations positions to be like in baseball,
yeah.
and you know, shows the one who's trying to change his life, one who's wants to turn his life around with religion, mm-hmm. one who wants to, you know, sort of
the person rather than the president, yeah. almost more.
I mean, and it, I mean, it shows like the confusion and disorganization that occurred when the Iraq War mm-hmm. began in 2003 and stuff like that.
I so. Think someone asked Oliver Stone if like he was ever if when he would do another, like, now that Bush is officially done and over, like, biopic or story about George W. Bush. And he said, basically, we got to wait 20 years. Mm. He's like, we waited 20 years to be able to do Nixon right. We should probably wait 20 years after George Bush to, like, have enough distance from it and removal from it that you can discuss it as a separate thing rather than something that's still active in people's
Which
brains.
Which is weird that he wanted to...
Well, I think I doubt he probably wants to. It's probably someone was like, "Are you gonna?" And he's like, "Well, if I did, I'd wait a crap load of time."
But it's weird that, you know, he did it while he's still in office.
Yeah, I know.
Like
that's why obviously someone thought of that question afterwards and after it had not succeeded.
it's so weird that he'd be like, change his mind, be like, "Yeah, you know what? Fuck it, I'll do it while he's here." Like,
I know.
I mean, I guess maybe he thought he could strike while the iron was hot, but
maybe he thought like, "Ooh, people will be so happy to see this because they're such a controversial figure."
But I think that's the reason why it fails, because it wasn't skewering him like the Democrats at home.
And it wasn't defending him.
Well, no, it wasn't. It's not that it wasn't defending him, but that Republicans assumed that it was going to skewer him and they're not going to support it because of that.
True.
So, sir, you're not pleasing either audience because of that.
That's definitely true. Yeah. Good point.
Moving right along to yet another true character. Mm-hmm. We're talking Milk, the Harvey Milk movie.
And to flip the inverse of No Country for Old Men, where he goes into the movie and then stops being in it. He doesn't even show up till 45 minutes into this one. Like, as a person as that's even talked about. Like, his character is not an existent
figure. They have to,
for understandable reasons.
They have to take Harvey Milk's character from, like, New York and bring him to San Francisco.
From the day of the... I think the film starts on the day that the...
assassination occurred.
The Jonestown Massacre happened. Like, it's when early in Milk's career, and then it...
Well, I mean, they start by talking about how he died, and then they cut back to, like, him and stuff like that. So, yeah, you know, I mean, they have to bring him out. They have to establish him as an activist. And it isn't until he wins political office that he meets Josh Brolin, who's a fellow supervisor.
Yes, playing Dan White.
And, you know, it's... I mean, this is obviously the origin of the Twinkie defense. I mean, they're...
So sad.
I'm trying to figure out where to begin. You know, a rivalry essentially, if you want to call it that, begins between Milk and White in that, you know, Josh Brolin's character is a conservative man. You know, he's comes from, I think, a Vietnam background.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, you're right.
And obviously Harvey Milk is a much more liberal character, and they sort try and sort of tepidly begin to understand each other and work with each other. And after White's hopes for support is spurned by Harvey Milk, he essentially turns towards him as a villain.
Yes.
Like, he looks at him, he doesn't even want to talk to him. He talks through, like...
vilifies him in his own mind.
And, you know, essentially, Harvey Milk sort of becomes the... I don't know if you want to call it the whipping boy or whatever for, like, a lot of his anger and frustrations. I mean,
Definitely the scapegoat and the focus all of his...
There's sort of this also underlying sort of hinting that he might have been gay.
Yeah, himself, like a homophobic type fear.
Self-hating sort of type thing. And, you know, ultimately it ends up like he leaves the office and then decides, you know, oh, never mind, I want to come back. And he's...
Very strangely.
Forced. He's essentially blocked from coming back. And he takes out that rage on Harvey Milk and... Was it Moscone?
Yeah.
Mayor Moscone. On the day that they're essentially going to announce that he's not coming back. And, man, you know, it's a tough one to watch because, I mean, it's one of the most just, like, sort of violent transitions you've ever seen occur. I mean, Harvey Milk is executed.
Yes.
Like, it's not just, like, you know, he's shot in passing or something like that.
Yeah, I think San Francisco, like, thanked Josh Brolin for portraying one of the, for properly portraying one of the most hated men in San Francisco's culture.
Well, I mean, Riot started because of it. It's a tough one to watch, and it's interesting. I mean, Gus Van Sant is one of those guys that, you know, he is very experimental, he's very unconventional, mm-hmm. and it can be tough to get into his film sometimes. So I think, you know, this is one of his more conventional narrative type films.
That's
which
true.
Helps.
Yeah, it definitely helps.
And it's not quite as experimental as something like Elephant. And having Sean Penn play your lead.
Oh, man, yeah.
Absolutely, who crushes that role.
He's fantastic.
He
does it so great.
You think about this, like, the film is really quite successful. I mean, Sean Penn won for Best Actor. It won for Best Original Screenplay. It was nominated for Best Picture. Mm-hmm. Lost to Slumdog. Josh Brolin was nominated for Best Supporting Actor. His only nomination
really
in his career, believe it or not. It's crazy. Of course, unfortunately, it occurred the same year as Heath Ledger in The Dark Knight.
Yes.
So he's not going to beat that.
Yeah.
And Gus Van Sant was nominated for Best Director.
Wow.
Lost to Danny Boyle. And it was nominated for a few other things, I think. Film editing, costume design. And Danny Elfman actually did the score for it, believe it or not, which is really interesting. Very unconventional for him as well. Mm-hmm. But, no, he's nominated. Lost to A.R. Rahman for Slumdog as well. But, you know, it's interesting.
Randomly, I thought it was funny. One of the random, like, trivia tidbits that's out there about this movie is they asked James Franco, for Pineapple Express, they asked him if he watched, like, Fast Times at Ridgemont High to get into his character, and he said, no, but he did get to make out with Spicoli, because he's Milk's lover in the film. So.
In the beginning, at least.
Yeah,
I mean, it's one of the interesting things, watching how passionate Harvey Milk is. They essentially pushes his love life to the side repeatedly.
Yes.
In pursuit
trying to,
of...
Like, almost conservatize his image for the purpose of legitimate...
And, I mean, it's a really interesting story to continue reading on, if you actually read on. I mean, that's really the end of the movie, is the death of him, but there's a whole lot that goes on with riots and stuff that occur after at the trial that essentially ended up becoming, like, somewhat of a farce.
Yeah. It's Twinkie defense. Come on, man.
Well,
actually thinks that's a good idea?
Well, also, I mean, just, like, you know, they never really interrogated him about anything.
Yes.
Like, it was really, like, his interrogation on tape, like, was done by a friend of his who was really simple. It's an interesting story. I definitely recommend looking into it more. Moving right along, though, we're going to drift back into the Coens and discuss True Grit.
Mm-hmm.
This was, again, based on a book.
Yes.
One that I hear is one of the most authentic or similar adaptations. Mm. This is what I was referring to with No Country for All Men. Like, the film is supposed to be almost identical to the book.
Yeah, they Coen brothers told Jeff Bridges to not worry, Jeff Bridges and Matt Damon to not worry about trying to pay any tribute to John Wayne or the original, because they were making it off of the original source material rather than trying to remake the film. So. Mm. Which I think worked amazingly for the film. So.
Yeah. And obviously this is the story of a girl who wants to avenge her father's death and ends up connecting with these two, I don't know, which one to call them out.
Well, one's essentially bounty hunter.
Yes.
The other's a Texas Ranger.
Yeah.
Both on the look for the same, she hires the bounty hunter essentially to track down her father's killer, and they encounter the Texas Ranger, who's also tracking down the same individual, played by Josh Brolin.
And you gotta give a lot of credit to the girl, Hailee Steinfeld, who's absolutely phenomenal in the film. I mean, she was nominated for an Academy Award, strangely, for Best Supporting Actress, which is ridiculous, because she's clearly, like, the lead in the movie.
Yeah, who would be the lead? Who are you going to try to say
is the lead?
I guess
Jeff Bridges or whatever. I mean, so she lost to Melissa Leo, no surprise there.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, she probably wouldn't have even beat Natalie Portman
for
Black Swan, even if she had been nominated properly.
Yeah.
But, nevertheless, you know, the thing that strikes me about this movie that I've said, at least in some context before, is that I feel like this is probably the most realistic cowboy movie that I've ever seen, in the sense that everyone's a fuck up.
Oh,
you know, I feel like most
everyone's
cowboy movies,
everyone's dirty, no one's shown as any.
Usually everything's so glamorized that, you know, like, cowboys, like, are always, like, badasses. They're shooting, like, everyone, you know, stuff like that. Nobody's, like, really that skilled. Like, Josh Brolin's character is completely like, dysfunctional.
The most functional person in the film is probably Hailee Steinfeld.
Yeah.
And if after her, the next best is probably Matt Damon's Texas Ranger, and then he goes and does something stupid like bite through most of his tongue in the movie and talk like a moron for the rest of the film. So
it's like
so, like you said, like, everyone, even that guy who's supposed to be all like, oh, I'm Texas Ranger out of state, I'm all awesome, he's a total screw up.
Which I really like about it. I mean, the film was enjoyable. A lot of people liked it.
It got
nominated for a slew of Academy Awards, but
won none of them.
But like, I never felt like it was really a realistic contender. I think a lot of people were surprised by the number of nominations.
I would say it's one of those films that I'm surprised the like more production quality side didn't win at least something, like cinematography or editing, or something along those lines, because it's a pretty clean and beautiful looking film.
I think a certain amount of it was pushed by the momentum of the Coen brothers. Like at that point, everyone was like, oh my god, the Coen brothers are so good. Like, and so it was like everything they were doing getting praise.
Like, when have the Coen brothers not been good? They've been good for a while, people. Sure. Come on.
But I think that pushed them to get a lot of those nominations.
I would say.
And I mean, obviously good performances and whatnot occurred as well. But, you know, the Academy Awards are one of those things that there's always like one or two films that dominate the momentum every year. And this just happened to be the year of King's Speech. So that took a lot of that stuff that was going on.
Just like The Artist was the this last one.
Yeah. So usually there's one film that's taken at least, you know, four or five, six of them at least. So
yes.
And that happened to be that one. So, but, you know, nominated for Best Picture, Best Performance by a Lead, Jeff Bridges. Best directors, best screenplay, blah, blah, blah.
A lot of stuff, yeah. All down the line. I find it also funny that Matt Damon, to get the effect of how he wanted the sound once he bit his tongue, just tied string around it or a rubber band or something. Basically, it tied up so that he would talk all funky.
Yeah.
Little tricks you learn.
That's good. Next up brings us to this Friday, the 11th of January. Gangster Squad comes out. This is directed by Ruben Fleischer, who did Zombieland in 30 minutes or less. This is based on a true story as well.
Yes.
The story of Mickey Cohen's fall, if you will.
I will.
As a gangster in Los Angeles, done in by a squad of, I don't know what
kind
you want to call
it. Off the books
cops, that's a good way to describe it, who are essentially giving, you know, the Miranda. We don't want to arrest people, just deal with
given
this problem.
Carte blanche.
And, you know,
a license to kill.
I just saw this film yesterday. I think I'll say, you know, I'll try and keep it brief in terms of like not spoiling it. It's a really fun film. You know,
good.
It's very well done. The acting's very good. I mean, Sean Penn is great. I mean, he again once embraces that sort of character so well. The thing that struck me the most is, in essence, it feels to me like a more stylized version of The Untouchables.
Oh yeah, like, I mean, I think that's clear from the get-go.
But like, I mean, it's so clear that, you know, like Sean Penn is definitely the Robert De Niro in this. You could sort of take Ryan Gosling and Josh Brolin's characters and mush them together and get Kevin Costner. You have Robert Patrick playing the Sean Connery role.
Yeah.
Then you have like Michael Pena and Anthony Mackie and Andy Garcia's role.
Garcia. Yeah.
Like, so, I mean, there's definitely these clear roles. Giovanni Ribisi is definitely the smart guy on the team. And unfortunately, because of that, you know, you can sort of suss out where the film is going, and you can make, I would make predictions based upon what happened in The Untouchables and that.
I see.
And,
well, I mean, you know, gangster stories with like a big gangster boss, they kind of have a somewhat inevitable.
Yeah, but you know, like they took some liberties with it, and I actually went to the trouble of like looking into the actual story of Mickey Cohen and whatnot. And in essence, it really did play out a lot like Al Capone. Like they definitely over.
They tried to do it normal. Then they tried to
play it sneaky
to get them.
I think they condensed a lot of it down, and then they dramatized it quite a bit in this movie, because you know they make it look like they really try and bring him down. But in essence, if you actually look at the story, like it was essentially tax evasion is how they got him, and they sent him to Alcatraz.
Yeah.
You know, he never really, like a lot of the characters that like these other mob characters in the movie that they make these like grand. And like things were like Mickey Cohen, it's like I want him assassinated, blah 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 blah. Like they didn't die in real life, they just sort of like had heart attacks and stuff later in life, and it's much more dramatic than the real life makes it seem.
But I mean, aren't gangsters probably much more dramatic than they actually are? I mean, isn't part of it that front, that face, that attitude?
They definitely play it up and make it more interesting, much like Argo. So I'm not going to say like you can't do it and it isn't worthwhile. But if you actually look into the actual true story that goes beyond there, there is definitely
some
creative liberties.
That's what I'm going to say.
Yeah, you know, I feel bad. And that's the other interesting thing. The reason why I was delayed is because there's a trailer that yes. played with The Dark Knight Rises, where they were shooting in a movie theater.
Yeah, they were coming through the screen from the opposite direction that the audience would be facing, out of the screen.
And they had to sort of
reshoot
because of that. But the interesting thing is you can't even tell where that would have fit in the plot.
I think it was supposed to be in the end, just so you know who has seen it. It was supposed to be, one of the final showdown dramatic shootouts was supposed to be that, and instead was wherever it was in the end.
It's at a hotel or something then. Because, I mean, it's interesting because there's I don't even know where you would have cut this out.
Which I guess is good because it means it's not so crucial that they're shoehorning you into some of the direction.
No, I mean, it's good, and the performances are good. I mean, the other thing that was sort of a bother is actually Josh Brolin. He's good in the film, but he sort of struck me in a Shia LaBeouf Lawless kind of way, where you're frustrated with him. He's good, but he kind of is a fuck up. If you actually sit back and look at what he's doing, he's constantly putting them in positions that are super dangerous or problematic. Rolls. He's definitely the driving force behind the team, which is good, but he's really not the key element of Ryan Gosling is really the one who's saving his ass all the time. Giovanni Ribisi is really the clever one. And the rest of them are just there as badasses.
Experienced backup.
Yeah. So it's a fun one. I definitely recommend it. And
I'm interested in seeing it with all the plebes.
Yeah.
When it actually comes out.
It's a good one. I definitely recommend checking it out. But, join us next week for our DVD rundown for the week of January 15th. Mm-hmm. And as always, you can find us at MacGuffinPodcast.com, Twitter.com/MacGuffinCast, Facebook.com/MacGuffinPodcast, phone number 323-761-9842. We're on iTunes. We're on Blip.tv, Roku, Miro.
Check in and get glue. Leave us some reviews. Tell us who you think is worse than American Gangster.
Love it.
Yeah, start a conversation. I'm guarantee if you talk about that movie, one of us is going to talk
back. I'll be there. Magneto can't stop me, I'm on fire tonight. Even Zod can't stop me, I'm on fire tonight. This tech don't even try to buy the same style. Mr. Spock can't stop me, I'm on fire tonight. The Wrath of Khan can't stop me, I'm on fire tonight. The Borg can't stop me, I'm on fire tonight. Because I've got space game and it feels alright.